Hi everyone, so this is the second video about symmetric random walk for the class APM 5 offer at ASU. So in the previous video, I talked about symmetric random walk on a finite connected graph. Now I'm going to look at symmetric random walk on ZD in general. Okay, so on ZD. On the d-dimensional integer lattice. I'm going to, for only this video, look at the case d equals 1 to study the process, but I'm going to define the process right now in any dimension. So in this case, well, that's basically the same random walk as the one we saw before, except that now the graph is infinite. And we assume that the set of vertices is equal to ZD, and the random walk can go to each of its four 2D nearest neighbors in D dimension. So if I draw a little picture of the graph, that would look locally like this in two dimensions, let's say. And that means that if your particle is here, then it's going to jump at the next time step to, for instance, this vertex, or this one, or this one, or this one, with the same probability 1/4. Okay, so 1/4 for each direction. In general, that would be 1/2D because you have 2D neighbors in D dimensions. So in this case, we again call xn the position of the particle at time n. And in this case, it's very convenient to write xn because of, you know, the graph is pretty regular. You can think of xn as the sum of n independent and identically distributed random variables that will show the direction of the jump at time n. And so in this case, you can just say that xn is equal to, let's say, y1 plus y2 up to yn, where those random variables yi are independent. So I can write that the yi are independent and they are in fact uniform. They are the uniform random variables, so on the set of all the possible directions. So that's going to be, let's say, e1 minus e1, e2 minus e2, and up to, let's say, ed minus ed, where basically ei is the unit vector in ZD that has the ith coordinate equal to 1, the other one equal to 0. So that corresponds to each of those directions. So in this picture, e1 is this vector, minus e1 is there, e2 is this vector, minus e2 is this vector. Okay? So we can write xn as a sum like this. Okay? That's just one observation. So now, you see that again, like in the previous lecture, the graph is connected, which means that if you take any two vertices, there is a path of edges connecting the two vertices. So that means that the random walk can indeed go from this vertex to this other vertex, meaning that the process is again going to be irreducible. But now the problem is that the state space is infinite. Okay. So state space is infinite, and so it's not clear whether the process is positive recurrent, null recurrent, or transient. And that's the main objective of this video. It's to study whether this random walk in one dimension is recurrent or transient. Okay. So let me just erase this for now. That was just to define in general this d-dimensional random walk, symmetric random walk, that I'm going to study again in the next lecture. But now we just assume that d equals 1, so we look at the symmetric random walk, on z, and I can remove the s here because in fact there is only one such random walk, and so in this case the picture we just get is we have something that starts at 0 and can go to move on the integers, negative 1, negative 2, and it's going to jump from 0 to 1 or 0 to negative 1 with probability 1/2. Okay, and it keeps doing that. So that corresponds to the process I defined earlier during the semester that we can define from a sequence of independent coin flip, okay, because there are only two options per jump. So now what we want to prove, it's part of what we call Polyar's theorem, and it's basically the following. So the theorem says that the process Xn that we define on one dimension, so let's say the symmetric random walk on Z, is what we want is to be able to say if this process is recurrent or transient. So I'm going to keep the suspense and I'm not going to give you the answer, and we can just look at the proof and then we can eventually deduce our theorem. So how do we prove, okay, that, how can we check that the process is recurrent or transient? So I mentioned several times that if you have an irreducible finite Markov chain, then the process must be positive recurrent. Now in this case, we are not in, that's not this situation. In this case, the process is again irreducible, meaning that all states are recurrent or all states are transient, but we cannot use finiteness of the state space to deduce recurrence, because in fact the state space is infinite. So intuitively it seems that because the state space is infinite, that doesn't look possible for the random walk to visit each state infinitely often. But then we need to do some little reasoning to check if indeed that's the case or not. So if you remember previous lectures, I told you that if a communication class is not closed, then this communication class must be transient. Here, the communication class is the whole state space, which is closed, so we cannot use this argument to deduce transient. And because the state space is again infinite, we cannot deduce recurrence either. So instead, to study this process, what we need to look at, if you remember, it's a theorem I mentioned a few weeks ago. We need to check whether, or let's say study some infinite sum. So study the infinite sum for n equals, let's say, 0 to infinity of Pn. So let's say just 0, 0. Okay? We know that the infinite sum of the Pn xx is going to be equal to the infinite sum of the Pn 0, 0 because the process is translation invariant. So we just need to study this. And there is this theorem saying that if this infinite sum is infinite, then state 0 is recurrent by irreducibility. That means that all the states are recurrent and the process itself is said to be recurrent. Then at the opposite, if this infinite sum is finite, then the process is transient. So how can we, so now the goal is to compute this. So by computing, I don't mean that we need an exact expression of the sum, but at least what we need to do is to study the asymptotic behavior of this probability Pn, Pn 0, 0. And clearly that goes to zero when n goes to infinity. That means basically, for instance, if you flip a coin thousands of times, what is the probability that you had exactly the same number of heads as the number of tails? That's mostly unlikely. So this goes to zero, but does it go to zero fast enough so that the sum is finite or not? And that's something which is not obvious. So so to study this, we first observe that when many of those terms, in fact, are equal to zero, if you look at your random walk, you clearly need an even number of steps to return to state zero. So which means that Pn 0, 0 is equal to zero whenever n is going to be odd. So we can just look at the infinite sum of the P2n 0, 0 instead. So in fact, this is equal to the infinite sum for n equals 0 to infinity of P2n 0, 0. And then this term can be computed kind of explicitly, except that we need still need to study the asymptotic behavior of this term as n goes to infinity. So what is P2N00? That's the next step of the proof. So P2N00 is in fact equal to the number of possible ways the random walk can go from 0 to 0 in 2n time steps. Okay, so that means that, so we need to look at this, that's going to be a large integer. We need to multiply that by the probability that indeed the random walk does that. You see that it doesn't matter in which order the random walk is going to jump right or left and returning to 0. At each time step, it's going to follow indeed the direction of some trajectory we have in mind with probability 1/2 at each step. Okay, so basically most of the point is to compute the number of ways the random walk can go from 0 to 0 in 2n steps. That means in fact that in the first 2n time steps the random walk is going to jump n times to the right and n times to the left. It's the only way you can return to your initial position. That means the number of left jumps and the number of right jumps should be equal. So in fact the number of trajectories is just the number of ways you can choose n jumps to be jumps to the right, and the other jumps are going to be jumps to the left. So the number of possible trajectories is simply equal to 2n choose n. Okay? Now, if you fix such a trajectory with 2n jumps and you want the random walk to follow this trajectory, then indeed the random walk is going to follow this path with probability, well, 1/2 at each step, but there are 2n time steps, so that's going to give you a 1/2 at the power 2n. Okay? So that's this times 1/2. At the power 12. Okay. So now, is it true that the infinite sum of those terms is finite or infinite? Well, that's not obvious because this 1/2 at the power 12 goes to 0 exponentially fast, but you understand again that when this term is the number of ways you can choose n elements from a set of 2n elements, that's also going to go to infinity exponentially fast. And it's not clear whether the product goes to 0 fast enough. So, to solve the problem, we need to use something called Stirling formulas. So maybe, let me write, I'm out of space here. Let me write Stirling formula here. So the trick is to use something called Stirling formula, and Stirling formula is something that it's a formula that gives you some the asymptotic behavior of n factorial, and n factorial appears here in this 2n choose n. So Stirling formula says that n factorial is about, it's of the order of square root of 2 pi n times n over e at the power n. Okay, so this is some asymptotic behavior when n is large. So, which means that n factorial divided by this quantity converges to 1 as n goes to infinity. So, that's what we are going to use to understand the behavior of this 2n choose n. And then we can look at the product with 1/2 at the power 2n after. So, if you look at 2n choose n, okay, so this is just equal to, I don't need parentheses here, so this is just equal to 2n factorial divided by n factorial square. And so this is not equal but of the order of when n is large. It's of the order of when you just use Stirling formula that tells you that in the numerator it's of the order of square root of 4 pi n times 2n over e at the power 2n, and you have to divide this, you have to divide this by this square, okay, n factorial square, so it's 2 pi n, and then you still have n over e at the power 2 n. Okay, so you see that the square root of 4 is the same as 2, so this disappears. And then you end up, after simplification, so you still have this square root, this 1 over square root of pi n, that stays here. So that's equal to 1 divided by square root of pi n. And then what's left is, after simplification, you just have 2 at the power 2 n. Okay, so let me write it here. So you have a 2 at the power 2 n. Okay, so now we see that indeed it goes to infinity very fast. Okay, so this was expected, but now we know really we have a more precise like behavior. So now if we use, if we replace this expression here in this expression there, transition probabilities, then what we get is some asymptotic behavior of that. We see the asymptotic behavior of that, and then that's about, well, this times 1 half at the power 2n, which simplifies with the 2 at the power 2n, okay? So eventually we just get that this, the probability of going from 0 to 0 in 2n steps behaves like 1 over square root of pi n, okay? So I can erase that because I'm out of space, and then that's a consequence of our calculation that that this 2n step transition probability behaves like is of the order of, let's say, square root of 1 over pi n. Okay? So this is only the behavior when n is large. And now the question is, well, if that's indeed, if you look at the infinite sum of those terms, so of course we need to exclude 0, it's not defined as 0, but the first terms don't matter to decide whether this infinite sum is infinite or not. So is it true that this goes to 0 fast enough so that this sum is infinite, is finite? Well, no, that's not the case. Okay. I hope you remember that if you have an infinite sum of, let's say, 1 over n at the power alpha, then that's going to converge to a finite limit if and only if alpha is strictly larger than 1. Here, your alpha is 1 half, okay? So that's less than 1, so that means that this infinite sum here is infinite, okay? So finally, we were able to prove, again, I'm going to erase this part, using some basic probability theory and Stirling formula, we were able to prove that this infinite sum is infinite. So, infinite sum infinite, so now I don't need this anymore. The infinite sum is infinite means that according to this theorem I mentioned previously, this means that state 0 is recurrent, and so because the process is irreducible again, that means the symmetric random walk on Z is in fact recurrent. So that's an interesting result that is not obvious intuitively because the state space is infinite, so it doesn't seem likely that the process can visit all the states infinitely often, but that's in fact what happens. All the states are visited infinitely often, and so the process, the symmetric random walk on the integers is recurrent. So now that's our first result, and that's the main result of this video, but I want to show you a few other tricks. So first one is there is in fact, so the proof I showed you is some kind of, you know, I would say very robust in the sense that you can use this, like look at this infinite sum to check if a process with infinite state space is recurrent or not. But there is a trick to study the symmetric random walk based on some like nice symmetry argument to argue that indeed the process is recurrent. So I'm just going to draw a picture to show you how it works. So let's say that here you have Z, and then you just say, well, what is the probability that the process never returns to zero. And we want to prove that this is zero. So basically, I want to look at the probability starting from zero that the time it takes to return to zero is infinite. Okay? So if I can prove that this is equal to zero, then this means that with probability 1 starting from zero, we return to zero with we return to zero, and so the process should be recurrent. So we just need to prove that this is infinite. And so the way you can do that is just by saying, well, let's assume that we start at zero. Without lossup generally, we can assume that the first jump is on the right. If it's on the left, you have some symmetry thing that you can use, so that doesn't really matter that you jump first right or left. Eventually, the probability of returning to zero should be the same. So now you just said that the probability, so once you're in state one, the probability that t0 is infinite is exactly the probability that you are going to reach state two before state zero. Okay? The probability that you are going to reach state 2 before state 0 is clearly 1 half. So I'm going to write that this is a 1 half. Okay. Then once you are in state 2, the probability that you never, okay, given that you are in state 2 at some point, the probability that you will never return to 0 is exactly the probability that you are going to reach state 4. Okay, before state 0, starting from 2. Again, no need to do any calculation. The random walk is symmetric. If it starts at the middle of an interval, the probability that it reaches the left boundary before the right boundary should be 0, should be 1 half. So you have this times 1 half again. Okay, times 1 half. But, and then you keep going. So that's state 4. Then you go twice more. So 5, 6, 7, 8. And then again, now that your random walk is here, what is the probability that it's going to never return to zero? Well, that's, you need for that the random walk to reach eight, state eight, before returning to zero. That has, again, a probability 1 half. And if you keep going like that, then eventually you get that this is 1 half at the power infinity, okay, which is zero. Okay. So that's a nice symmetry argument that tells you that, well, indeed, if you start from state zero, the probability that you never return to zero means that you have to, you know, keep going right, and you have this infinite product of one half. Okay, so that's another possible proof. This one is just something that works in this case. That's not something that works always. But that's a nice thing to know. So I'm going to remind you this result, I'm going to repeat this result here. So recurrent means that indeed this should be zero, and so in particular the probability starting from zero that t0 is finite should be equal to 1. Okay, that's the definition of recurrence for state 0. And now, so we were able to prove that the symmetric random walk on Z is recurrent. But now there is again a distinction between positive recurrent and null recurrent. So is it positive recurrent or null recurrent? Well, here to argue that, you know, to try to understand this aspect, one basic argument would be to say, well, let's assume that indeed the process is positive recurrent. Well, then, if it's positive recurrent, and we know that it's irreducible, then the theory of Markov chain tells you that it should have a unique stationary distortion. Okay? So, let's assume that the process is positive recurrent, which is not the case, in fact, but by contradiction. So, positive recurrent. So, if it's the case, then that should imply that there is a unique stationary distribution pad. But then, if you look at the structure of the graph, then everything is translation invariant. So that means that pi x should be the same for all x. Okay? So by symmetry, we can clearly see that pi x should be equal, let's say, to pi y for all x, y in z. So meaning that basically phi is the uniform distribution on z. But it turns out that there is no such distribution. So why is that? Well, if phi x is equal to zero, then all the terms of the stationary distribution are equal to zero, so you get a measure with total mass equal to zero that cannot be a distribution. If at the opposite, you assume that pi x is strictly positive, but it's constant, so it's going to be equal to a positive constant, let's say c, then the total mass of pi, that's the infinite sum of the pi x, it's going to be, well, c plus c plus c plus c infinitely many times, which is infinite. So, which means that, in fact, the uniform measure on z are indeed invariant or stationary, but their total mass can only be equal to zero or infinity, and there is no way to divide by some constant to make the total sum equal to one. So, this simple argument shows you that basically positive recurrence leads to some contradiction. And so that means that the process should be null recurrent. Okay? So now, what does it mean to be null recurrent? That means that the mean recurrence time in each of the states is infinite. So we get, if we look at state 0, expected value starting from 0 of t0 is infinite. And here we have some interesting property that we didn't see before about the one-dimensional random walk. It's the fact that if the particle, if you have this particle, a particle here starting at zero, going right or left with equal probability, then the time you have to wait until you return to zero is finite with probability one, but in average, this time is infinite, okay? Which is a weird thing, okay? You have a time, you have this random variable t0 that is almost surely finite, but has an infinite expected value. Okay, and I think I told you like everything you can find in my book about the one-dimensional symmetric random walk. Now I'm going to stop the video and I'm going to do one more about the symmetric random walk on Z2. And I will briefly tell you about the behavior in higher dimension, but the proof becomes messy, so I skip that.